Homeopathy are glorified sugar pills. Here in the cold and flu aisle, oscillococcinum sits right next to actual medicines, claiming to relieve flu-like symptoms. It contains no active ingredient. On the label, it'll say Anis barbarii, which means it has duck and heart liver, but those are diluted to the point of actually having no active ingredient at all.
So there is a lot of misinformation on the internet, and it's often hard to tell what's factual and what is not. Dr. Andrea Love is an immunologist and microbiologist who founded Immunologic, a science and health education organization that tackles pseudoscience.
And she joins us now. Thank you for being with us.
Thanks so much for having me, Lauren and Robin.
Well, you know, there's some statistic that I'm probably going to get wrong about the number of things, and even the doctor information on TikTok, for example, the percentage of it that's correct is really disturbingly low.
Yeah, absolutely. And current data suggests that about 80% of adults, particularly younger adults in the Gen Z demographic, are getting health and science information from TikTok.
It's interesting because on Instagram, you know, you see a lot of people talk about organic foods and the things that you need to avoid. And then I look and it says dietitian or it says doctor or nutritionist. And then I begin to wonder, it's like, well, actually, are they, or is this just somebody that is on there saying that they are? How frustrating is it for you to see some of these things on social media and with such large exposure?
Yeah, I mean, I think for me, the desire to kind of combat this sort of pseudoscience and misinformation has always stemmed from a way to alleviate undue health anxiety and also save people money ultimately, because a lot of these things that are often promoted as being good for your health or better than an alternative, not only do they typically not have evidence to support it, but they're usually much more expensive. And that's not to mention the other harms that could be associated with some of these things.
Okay, so let's talk about some of the misinformation about Lyme disease that you've seen.
Yeah, so Lyme disease, I've been in the Lyme disease field. I actually grew up in Eastern Connecticut and I've lived in the epicenter my entire life. And so Lyme disease is a very real concern. It's a bacterial infection that's transmitted by two specific species of ticks in the US. But what people have been led to believe, and there's a variety of organizations that kind of promote this misinformation, is that it's much easier to get infected than it is in reality, that once you've gotten infected, you're going to be infected forever, that it's transmitted in other ways besides these two species of ticks. And what it does is it creates a lot of undue fear about going outside, about spending time, you know, with your family. And it also leads people to fall down this rabbit hole of unvalidated and inaccurate tests that ultimately tell people that they have Lyme disease when in reality those tests are not validated for accuracy. And so because Lyme disease, if you don't have that typical bullseye rash, the symptoms are quite generic, fatigue and lethargy and headache and joint pain. And those can be due to a lot of other medical conditions. And so it's really important to use credible infectious disease specialists in order to diagnose you appropriately, because 95% of Lyme disease cases occur in 15 states in the Northeast and the Midwest US. And there are places in the US that Lyme disease is almost unheard of because the ticks and the bacteria don't exist there in high enough numbers to be a public health concern.
I'm curious, do you think food sensitivity tests work? I know I've taken one before, I have friends that have taken them, and I didn't really even know what to do with the results.
Yeah, so food sensitivity tests are really interesting because they really, again, exploit this desire to take control of your health. But what they're testing for is a type of antibody called IgG or immunoglobulin G. Now, when we're talking about food allergies, we're looking for an immune response that's associated with an IgE antibody, so a different class of antibodies. In the context of foods, when you eat foods, those food particles enter your GI tract and they interact with a component of the immune system called the GALT, the gastrointestinal associated lymphoid tissue. And there, what they do is they sample all these food molecules and they produce IgG as an indication of I'm tolerating these food particles. So using these food sensitivity tests that are looking for this IgG antibody don't actually tell you if you're reacting to a food. It actually simply tells you that you've eaten the food, your body notices it, it says you don't need to react to it, and it's an indication of tolerance of those foods. And so these tests are telling people that they're reacting to all these foods when in reality it just means that they ate that food recently. And it causes people to stop eating those foods that probably, you know, are healthy to begin with and are not causing health issues for them.
Well, for, you know, for more information and you want to sort all this out, you can check out Andrea's website, Immunologic. I'm having a hard time saying that. Immunologic.org. And you can follow her on social media for all the debunking. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.